Shalom. This week, Sedra is Sedra's Behar and Bechukosai. God spoke to Moshe on Mount Har Sinai, and God said, speak to the Jewish people and say to them, when you enter the land that I give you, the land shall observe a Sabbath of the Lord. 6 years you may sow your field, 6 years you may prune your vineyard and gather in the produce of the field. But in the seventh year, the land shall have a Sabbath of complete rest, a Sabbath of the Lord. You shall not sow your field or prune your vineyard. In this verse, the Hebrew phrase for the words a Sabbath of complete rest is Shabbat Shabbaton, a double language and repeated word of Shabbat. Hebrew doesn't usually repeat words, and it's not a literary tool to express emphasis. It's a curious turn of phrase. In his commentary to the phrase Shabbat Shabbaton, Sforno wrote that the double language meant to convey the Jewish people have to completely refrain from working the land during the Shemitah year, including preparatory work. In a different approach, the Ibn Ezra pointed to earlier psukim that discussed Yom Kippur and also called Yom Kippur a Shabbat Shabbaton. The Torah reads, this shall be to you a law for all time. In the seventh month, on the 10th day of the month, you shall afflict yourselves, and you shall do no manner of work, neither the citizen nor the alien who resides among you. For on this day, atonement shall be made for you to cleanse you of all your sins. You shall be clean of sin before the Lord. It shall be, and here's the phrase, a Sabbath of complete rest, Shabbat Shabbaton, for you, and you shall practice affliction. It is a law for all time. In his commentary on Yom Kippur as Shabbat Shabbaton, the Ibn Ezra wrote, some say that Shabbat Shabbaton means rest for the soul and rest for the body, for the word Shabbat is repeated in the phrase. Others say that Shabbat Shabbaton means a rest greater than all other rests. It means a total rest. These comments of Ibn Ezra deserve explanation. In his explanation of the mitzvah of Shemitah, the Sefer HaChinuch wrote that Shemitah fixes in our hearts and our minds the matter of the world having been created. In order to remove the idea of the eternity of the world from our thoughts, which the deniers of the Torah believe in, the requirement is to expend all of our time, day by day, year by year for Shemitah by counting 6 years and resting on the seventh, so that the idea of God as creator, matter will never depart from our minds. The mitzvah of Shemitah isn't just to let the land lay unused for the year. It's a seven-year cycle where throughout the 7 years, we contemplate the seventh year and why we're not going to plant that year. We take that year to think about God as creator, taking a break from the daily grind for an entire year, and contemplating God is an opportunity that wouldn't be available to people if not for the Torah's command to keep Shemitah. In a microcosm, we have a mini Shemitah every single week. Every Shabbat, we have the opportunity to take a break and spend time contemplating God. That is the Shabbat, the rest that the Torah discusses. A complete rest, a Shabbat Shabbaton, is when the opportunity to contemplate God that we have weekly is extended. On Yom Kippur and Shemitah, we don't just have a Shabbat, but the time is enhanced by fasting, praying, and avoiding physical comforts. Or in the case of Shemitah, taking an entire year to contemplate God. The Ibn Ezra offered two explanations to the Shabbat Shabbaton description of Shemitah. The first was saying that it was a rest for body and soul. On Shabbat, we rest our body, but the rest for the soul is temporary. It's only 25 hours. Shemitah provides a rest for the soul for an entire year. He also called Shemitah the greatest rest. His explanation speaks to the quantity of Shemitah an entire year and to the quality of contemplation created by an entire year. The Ibn Ezra's explanations help us understand the unique benefits of the Shemitah year. What a powerful lesson. Shabbat Shalom.